Здравствуйте, меня зовут Volker. Я работаю в SAP, 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 не знаю, как угодно, в Германию. В отдел, который разрабатывает SAP JVM, это наша виртуальная машина. Она базирована на HotSpot, на OpenJDK, но мы его портировали на много разных платформ, как, например, AAX, HPUX, PowerPC, S390, Itanium, PRISC и так далее. Мы тоже работаем, наша виртуальная машина, она лицензионная, но мы тоже работаем в OpenJDK. Мы добавили PowerPC порт, AAX порт и недавно S390 порт, несколько недель назад в OpenJDK, и их задержаем там. Да, вот доклад, наверное, будет сложно вам, если вы еще не работали в виртуальной машине, поэтому не стесняйтесь, спросите, и во время доклада я попробую все вам рассказать. Про HotSpot говорить мне проще по-английски, поэтому доклад будет по-английски. Okay, so let's start. What are intrinsics? If we look at Wikipedia, so intrinsics are so-called built-in functions which are handled specially by a compiler. They are not special for HotSpot. They exist since a long time in actually all programming languages. And by definition, the compiler or interpreter knows the semantics of special functions and knows better how to optimize them, so he can replace them by special optimized code. So, for example, GCC, the C compiler, has a lot of intrinsics, also the Microsoft Visual C compiler. In GCC, for example, B0 function or nprintf string duplication and so on. These are all functions from the standard C library, but they usually get intrinsified. It means they get replaced by a special handcrafted code. So to make them faster in Java, it's usually the mathematical functions, array copy, and in the last time, a lot of intrinsics have been added for all the cryptographic functions like MD5, AES, and so on. But intrinsics are not only used for performance improvement, they can also be used to express things which are not directly expressible in the language itself. For example, new CPUs from Intel and PowerPC from IBM, they have support for transactional memory, but for example, C has no notion of transactional memory. So GCC offers these functions like x begin, x end, which are translated right into the corresponding transactional memory instructions of the CPU. In Java, for example, there are functions like unsafe allocate instance, which instantiates a Java object without calling the constructor. This is not defined by the Java language or by the Java semantics. So, of course, this cannot be implemented in pure Java. So, again, this is replaced by special handcrafted code in the virtual machine. Recently, a thread on spin rate was added to Java 9 by Azul, for our colleagues from Azul. And again, this if a CPU supports a spin operation, this function call will be translated right into the spin operation. Otherwise, it will be ignored. Also, you can get direct access to CPU instructions. For example, in Visual Studio, you can use intrinsics like move or multiply with 128 bits right from C by using this C functions, but actually it's intrinsics. Also, for example, in Java, you can call unsafe load fence to insert a load fence, a memory fence into your program. So let's start with a small program. Hello world program. It has a say hello function, and we print hello jetconf. And we just take in the main function, we just get the time, call the function, and see how long it takes. So when we can you read it? When we execute this program, you see it takes about two seconds. And now let's call it with a new option which I've introduced called x minus xx plus jetconf, and you see that's a lot faster because what I've done, I've intrinsified this call. I don't call the Java implementation of say hello, but instead I directly print this string to the screen. So if I call my if I edit my program now and say hello people, let's say, and recompile it, you will see that when I call it, it will print hello people, but when I use the version with the intrinsified version, it still prints hello jetconf, because obviously if a function gets intrinsified, the virtual machine or the compiler, the runtime system, has to know the exact semantics of this program, and it implements this semantics. So if you change the semantics, the intrinsic won't work anymore. So that's actually the reason why intrinsics cannot be, at least in Java, there's no possibility to define intrinsics for your user code. So intrinsics can only be specified for the standard standard API functions, and they are implemented in the virtual machine. Because only for the standard functions, there is a definition which explains what it does. So you have already seen what problems you can have. There are other problems with intrinsics. So maybe you know that in Java we have possibility to instrument bytecode. This is, for example, used by support tools or profilers. It allows to dynamically change the bytecode at runtime, and it's also used by code coverage tools and loggers and so on. The problem is that you cannot instrument intrinsified methods, or the other way around. Even if the method is intrinsified, even if the method is instrumented, if the hotspot intrinsifies this method, it's not aware of the instrumentation. So you're not supposed to read this code here. I just have it here if you want to look at the slides later on. The slides are all online. So you can write an instrumentation agent which prints method entry and exit events at every method entry and exit. And if you can create a jar file from it. I've detailed how to do this here. So we just compile the program. We use this manifest with a so-called pre-main class. The pre-main class specifies which class will be called when the agent will be loaded into the VM. And then we create a jar file with this manifest and with our class. And then we can just run it in this way. We call Java, we say we want to load a Java agent, the Java agent which we've just written, method instrumentation agent, and we want to instrument all methods in the package org Simonis. And then we run our Hello World program again. And the obvious output is like, we enter the main method, we enter the say hello method, then we get the output from say hello, we exit say hello, we exit main. Now when we run all this with the intrinsified version of say hello, we won't get this instrumentation code for the reasons I've explained to you before. There is another possibility to change Java bytecode dynamically through JVMTI. It's a Java Virtual Machine tool interface. It allows programs to inspect and control the execution of the VM, and it's a native interface into the virtual machine, and this is a standardized interface, so not only HotSpot, every Java compatible implementation has to implement it, and it's mostly used by debuggers and profilers. Again, for reference, I have put an implementation here. It's again not more than 100 lines of code. We don't go through the details, just call it. So you load this native JVMTI agent with the agent pass options on the command line, and again we instrument method entry and exit events. the output looks a little different, but it's actually semantically the same. We enter hello world main, say hello, we see the output of the say hello method, and we exit the two methods. And again, when we run with the intrinsified version by specifying plus jetconf, we won't enter this instrumented code because it was replaced before. It was replaced no matter how it was changed before. So you may say that that's not so important for you because you don't use JVMTI or things like or instrumentation. But JVMTI, for example, is used in the debugger, and I can show you an example how this looks in the debugger. So when we start our program, our Hello World program for debugging, and we don't use the intrinsic. And now in this window, we will just attach to the program. And then we will place a breakpoint, stop in org. And then we continue. We obviously stop in the breakpoint. We see we are in this method. We continue and run till the end of still application exits. Now we start the program again, but this time with the intrinsified version. And you may already guess what happens. So let's try it. So we place the breakpoint. The debugger actually placed the breakpoint into the program, but it didn't stop at the breakpoint. Again, because breakpoints work by instrumenting the bytecode. But if we don't execute this bytecode at all, because we replace the whole function with an optimized native implementation, we don't have a chance to stop. And actually, there is a bug open since some time already, which say intrinsics for Java methods don't take class redefinition into account. So when a Java method is replaced with an intrinsic version during compilation, it doesn't take into account whether the actual bytecode was replaced or not using instrumentation or JVMTI. But it's not considered so important, so this bug has been postponed to Java 10. So you still have this problem. But as I told you, because only a special set of standard functions from the library can be intrinsified, this isn't such a big problem for user code. And it's actually hard to really fix this, because you can intrinsify methods which call other methods which call certain methods and so on, and to keep track of all this, it's very hard. So I'm not sure if this really can be fixed. So let's have a look at another example how intrinsification really works. All what I showed you until now, this Hello World example, was just an example to give you an impression how things work. So now let's look at a more serious example. I have a compute function here, and it runs in a loop and just does some mathematical computation. It takes a sinus, square root, and pow. And from the main program, we just read the count, how many times we should iterate in our compute function. We read it from the input in the first argument, and then we first call our compute function 20,000 times, enable to JIT compile it. You probably know that at the beginning, that as already Nikita told, the Java methods are executed in interpreted mode in the Java virtual machine, and if the virtual machine realizes that the method gets hot because it's called a lot of times, it just in time compiles it to native code. So in order to trigger this native compilation, we call our compute methods for 20,000 times with the count 1, so that this happens very fast. And afterwards, we call it one time with a big count value, which we pass on the command line. So let's have a look what happens. So you can see that if you call this, first we warm it up. We use the command line options print compilation and print inlining. Print compilation lets the VM dump all the JIT compilation events to standard out. So we can see that when we call the VM, a lot of functions get compiled. And if we additionally use print inlining, we also see which functions have been inlined during compilation. So for example, for our compute function, which we're interested in, we call Java lang mass sinus. And this is actually not inlined. Like for example, a string in code was inlined into string replace. But we have this annotation here, which says this method was intrinsified. If I clear the screen so you can see it better. If we disable these intrinsics, so they can be disabled with the special options, minus inline mass natives, you will see that this looks a lot different now. And to explain you what happened, let's look here. We compile our compute function, then we call sinus, but now it's not intrinsified. So there is actually an implementation of sinus in the standard library. And this function calls the strict mass implementation of sinus. And the same applies for SQRT. And strict mass sinus, again, is a native method, as you can see. There are, for example, CPUs which don't offer mathematical instructions. So for them, it's important that Java has an implementation of sinus. So sinus runs on all platforms, even on embedded platforms or processors like Itanium, for example, which don't have mathematical instructions. But you see the code, it's a lot longer now, and it takes like 32 seconds opposed to compared to 2 seconds, like 10 times longer if we don't intrinsify this code. Okay. So let's have a look at the actual at the generated code. So we did this is the same example. We use the print compilation, print inlining options, and there is now we use an additional option called compile command. With this option, we can pass arguments to the just-in-time compiler to give us more information. And we say we want that it prints the generated code for our compute function. And if we run that, we will see that. So this is where we now compile our method, and we get the information about the generated code. And we can see that, for example, square root, it just translates the call to square root into a single CPU instructions by using the XMM extension of the Intel CPU. So, for example, for sinus, there is no direct implementation which fits the Java specification. So we still have calls here, but these are so-called leaf calls. So this is special calls where we just call optimized native implementation of sinus, and we know that this function doesn't call any other Java function. So that's why it's called leaf call. This can be optimized in the virtual machine. So if we do the same again, but without inline natives and run it, you will see that the code gets a lot. Sorry, thanks. I try just one more time. Sorry for So we see that now we have a real call here. It's a static call to Java lang strict mass square root, because mass square root was inlined, as we saw in the inlining trace, and then it called the square root function, which was a native function. And you may see that this is a real call now, and for this call, the virtual machine accounts a lot of things. So, for example, it remembers all the objects, the Java objects, which are live at this point, because at every call site to native is also a potential safe point in Java. So when we call a native function, it may be that this takes a lot of time, and during this time, some other thread may want to allocate memory, and if there is no memory left, we have to start a GC, and we don't want to wait until this native function stops. So we have to know, while other threads are in native, the state of that thread before it went into the native call. And we need this as the root set for starting the GC. We will see why this is important in a second, because we will now slightly change our demo program. So to show you problems which may arise if you have intrinsics and save points and time to save point. So we have the same program like before with the same compute function. The only thing we change is that we add this code here to our main method. So before calling compute with the huge count, which we set on the command line, we start a thread. So it's actually a daemon thread. And we have here a while true loop, which sleeps for 1 second and then calls systemgc. So every second we call systemgc and we start this thread. So it runs concurrently and then we start our compute function. And let's see how this is now different. So we run now this program loop with GC. We start without using the intrinsics, and we use the verbose GC option, so we get notified when a GC happens. So when we start this program, there is nothing special. So about every second we get a GC, and we knew that it will run about 20 seconds, so we don't wait until it stops. So now let's see how this looks when we use the intrinsics. So we see we had one GC at the beginning when the program runs, but we see no GCs. Actually, we would have expected that every second the GC happens, but only at the end the first GC happened. And of course the program was faster, just 9 seconds, but no GC happened so far. So why is this so? If you remember the machine code which we've looked before, in the case where we have intrinsified all the mathematical functions, either they were just translated right into CPU instructions, or we had these leaf calls which don't have a save point. So now we have a very tight loop which runs for a very long time, and if another thread wants to stop the VM in a save point, it has no chance because it has to wait until this thread stops. So this can be a big problem for latency, for example. It may stop your Java application for a long time. For example, like in this example, you would have to wait like 9 seconds for a GC. So if a thread needs to allocate and cannot do a GC, all your application may stop for such a long time. This is again a known problem. There is a bug for it, and it was resolved by adding the use counted loop save points, but it's switched off by default because as I told you before, every call, every return from a function is a potential safe point site in HotSpot, and also every back branch. So if you have a loop in Java, every time a while loop, a for loop, every time you jump back in a loop, this is a potential safe point. But this is not so for int loops. It's just for uncounted loops. That means if you have something like a while true loop, which runs indefinitely. But if you have so-called counted loops, which is a loop from one to a known value, which is an integer, the HotSpot thinks that this is executed so fast that there is no point in doing a safe point check every time for every loop iteration, because this comes at a certain cost. Every safe point check is actually an instruction to see if the thread should stop for a safe point. And because it thinks that integer loops are executed, I mean, they can run a maximal five billion times. So on new hardware, that should be quite fast. But if we intrinsify things into a counted loop, as we saw, this still can take considerable amount of time. So we can fix this with use counted loop safe points. If we use that option as here, so it's the same call like before. We use intrinsics and we use counted loop safe points, and you see now we use the mathematical intrinsics. We get the GC every second. The program is like it was 9 seconds before, and it's nearly 10 seconds now, so it's slightly slower because we have the safe point check in every loop. But I think most people expect this behavior. So if you have latency problems in your code, you may try this option. It may help in specific situations. Okay, this was... Are there any questions so far? No, okay. So, some more general words about intrinsic implementation in HotSpot. So, every intrinsic is defined in a source file, VM symbols, HPP. And there are different kind of intrinsics. There are so-called library intrinsics, which is actually what I showed you in the Hello World example. So there, a specific Java method is replaced either directly by machine instructions or by intermediate representation. We will come to this in a few minutes. So the JIT compilation process happens in several steps. So first, the JIT compiler reads the bytecode. Then it translates this bytecode into a graph representation, to an abstract syntax tree. This is a so-called ideal graph. This is the same on all platforms. And then it performs certain optimization on this tree representation of the bytecode. And after several optimization steps, it matches these nodes of this graph against so-called machine nodes. These machine nodes are different on every platform. So, for example, on x86, these machine nodes already contain the exact machine instructions which have to be executed for an abstract node. Like you can imagine, we have an add node or a subtract node, which is abstract because it's the same. But then, on a specific hardware, it translates into a specific add instruction on Intel or different instructions on PowerPC and so on. And we can also replace calls to functions by a subtree, by intermediate representation. We will see how that works. We also have so-called bytecode intrinsics. In this case, actually, we don't inline special functions. It's mostly the string buffer function and the boxing methods, because if you would inline them, we would lose some higher level information, and HotSpot has special handling for these functions in later optimization stages. So in some cases, we just leave these calls in and optimize them later on. And as I told you before, This can only be done for system classes with a standard virtual machine. Of course, if you compile your hotspot yourself, you're free to change it in any way. So this is how I prepared the Hello World example. But for this, you have to compile the hotspot yourself, which is actually not too hard nowadays. You just clone it, configure, make, and you can build your own OpenJDK. And then you can hack these files, which I'll show you here. And for your own fun, you can implement intrinsics for your own functions if you want. But your program won't work with the intrinsic right version on a standard VM. And since Java 9, all the intrinsics in the class library are now annotated with an internal annotation. It's called HotSpot Intrinsic Candidate. But it's a JDK internal class, so it can only be done for system classes. And it is checked that every method which is supposed to be intrinsified really gets intrinsified by the virtual machine. Because in the past, we had these problems, which I already mentioned in the beginning, that people renamed some functions in the standard library, and suddenly other people realized big performance regressions because some functions couldn't be intrinsified, because the hotspot part was not adapted. So now, with this change in Java 9, the hotspot can always check that every method which should be intrinsified is intrinsified in hotspot, and it can also check the other way around. If it finds some intrinsic candidates in the hotspot for which there is no function in the class library which has this annotation, it gives you a warning again and say, hey, I have an intrinsic for this method, but it doesn't exist, or it's not supposed to be intrinsified. It was too fast. So some more words about library intrinsics, because these are the main intrinsics which we have in hotspot. So as I already mentioned before, hotspot first interprets a program, then it can compile it with the so-called client compiler, and only in the end, when a method is really hot, it means it's really called a lot of times, it compiles it with the so-called C2 or server compiler. So we can have intrinsics on every stage, in the interpreter, in the C1, and in the C2, but most intrinsics are only implemented for the C2 compiler, because this is actually the code which should run in the end in your production system. So if you have a running system, usually like more than 90%, usually 95 to 98% of your code is executed in C2 JIT compiled code. If you see something different, then for some reasons your system is not running nice. But again, to save some startup time, some intrinsics like mathematical function and CSC, for example, there are also intrinsics in the interpreter. There are also very few intrinsics mostly for unsafe and for mass functions in the C1 compiler. As I told you before, so most of the intrinsics are implemented in the C2 compiler. And for the interpreter, we will see that. I will show you the example how we did it, how I implement the Hello World intrinsics. So how can we control intrinsics? As you have seen in the demos I have shown you before, it's one option which is nice is print compilation. Then you see when your methods get compiled, and you see on which level they get compiled. So in this example, I run with minus tiered compilation. I only used the C2 compiler. That's why I don't see the compilation level here. But if you run with tiered compilation, you also see the compilation level. So tier 1, tier 2, tier 3, or so on. And print inlining gives you the inlining tree of every method, and then you can see which method get intrinsified and which not. But the inlining tree is also useful if you, for example, have performance problems and look at the compilation of your program, and you see that you have a big method which inlines a lot of stuff, but one method maybe cannot be inlined. This can lead to some performance problems. Inlining is very complex in hotspot, and it's very hard to tune it, but there are inlining limits, for example, how many functions, how many levels of inlining you have, how big a method can be, that it can be inlined, and how big the inlinee can get at all. So you can a little bit play with these methods, with these parameters, but it's complex. If you tune it for a specific method, usually you will get worse results for other methods. So the defaults are quite good. Then we have the check intrinsics method, check in Java 9, which works together with HotSpot intrinsic candidates, which I told you before. And then we have really a huge bunch of different options to control intrinsics. There is the disable intrinsic method, which is the most general one. And this method uses the intrinsic IDs, which are defined in the VM structs file I mentioned before. So with this option, you can enable or disable every single intrinsic. It's mostly useful for testing, for debugging, and so on. Then we have print intrinsics. Then we have use intrinsics, which works for some intrinsics, plus or minus. We have inline natives, inline mass natives, which we used to disable our mathematical intrinsics. You can see from this zoo of different options that intrinsics have a very long history in HotSpot. So like maybe 10 years ago, people started to do optimizations by replacing methods with intrinsics. And there were very few of them, so they added options for every new intrinsic. And then as the number of intrinsic grow, also the number of options grew. And actually, in the beginning of the HotSpot, the intrinsic ID, which is defined in the VM structs file, was limited to 255. It was a byte. And like 2 or 3 years ago, this wasn't enough anymore, because now we have like already 300 or 400 intrinsics in the HotSpot. So it was extended to a short int, which now has like more has potentially enough slots for a lot of more intrinsics. Okay, so you may ask yourself, what's the difference between native methods and intrinsics? Because of course, if you want to speed up a Java method, you can just as well define it as native and provide a native implementation. So one difference is that the native call is a quite heavyweight instruction in Java because of the JVM state for the safe points. Because for every native call, as I told you before, the VM has to record a lot of data. Also, the Java calling conventions are different from the native C, C++ calling conventions. So usually, if you call from JIT compiled code to C or C++ code, there has some shuffling of arguments has to happen. And obviously, the native implementation is platform dependent. So if you have a native implementation which runs on Linux x86, it won't run on Windows or on Mac out of the box. Of course, that's the same with intrinsics. They have to be provided for every single platform, but that's done in the VM. But native methods still have their benefits. So for example, for expensive calls like I/O, or so that's okay, because you don't want to have an intrinsic for I/O. It's actually okay that you have a JVM state there and you can do GC in parallel and so on. So for certain kinds of things like graphics or I/O, database access and network, and so native methods are the right way to go. And hopefully the handling of native methods will improve in the future. There is a project Panama in OpenJDK which aims to dramatically improve the way how native methods can be implemented. So if you're interested in this topic, just have a look at Project Panama in OpenJDK. So let's just have a short overview how I implemented the Hello World example, concrete. So if you want, you can look at this code. I have all the source code on GitHub, in my GitHub repository, the slides and the code. So if you want, you can try it yourself. So as I told you before, in the VM symbols file, this is a huge actually C macro, which defines all the intrinsics which are recognized by the virtual machine. So this is actually the important line. It says that the VM, if it finds a method hello world in it's So hello world is the class, org Simonis hello world. Yes, this is defined here. And say hello name, it's say hello, it's the name of our function. And this is the, and hello, say hello signature, it's the signature. So it takes no argument and returns void. So if the virtual machine finds such a method in a class that it's loading, it will assign it this ID, this intrinsic ID, and will handle it specially. Then for the interpreter, we have different method kinds. So a usual method is just called zero locals. It has type, the method kind type is zero locals, so it means it's a normal method, and it has to initialize its local variables to zero. But for every intrinsic, there is a special method type in the interpreter. So for example, Java lang mass sinus intrinsic, there is a method type, and for our own intrinsic, we have to add our own intrinsic method type. And then there is the method called method kind. So when the interpreter executes a method, it has a handle to this method, and it asks the interpreter what kind of method is this. So we guarded this with the x minus xx jetconf options, which we used. If we switch it on, we will return the intrinsic ID of our say hello method. If the intrinsic ID of the method is say hello, then we will return our hello world method kind. And of course, now for every method kind, there's a special implementation, a special entry. And this is generated in the template interpreter generator. So the HotSpot interpreter, it's a so-called template interpreter. This means it's not a simple implementation which runs in a loop, reads a bytecode and interprets it, but instead it has already machine instructions for every bytecode. And these instruction snippets get generated at the VM start. So when the VM starts, it generates, for example, machine instructions for the add bytecode, for the jump bytecode, and so on. And in this step, we also now generate the special entry for our say hello world intrinsics. And the HotSpot has its own assembler. If you have ever wrote assembly code with ASM or with GCC or so, you may find this similar. But as I told you, the virtual machine has to generate bytecode dynamically on the fly while it's running. So it has a full macro assembler to dynamically generate bytecode during runtime. And we just, for our hello world intrinsics, it's just a few machine instructions. We define the constant of our string. We move the value of standard out to the first argument register. We move the address of our string to the second argument register. Then this is actually the machine instruction call. We just call the fputs functions, which is defined in the standard C library. And then we pop the arguments and return. So that's it. So that's why it was so much faster, because when the Java implementation called system out print line, this again has some Java indirection level before it finally does a native call, which again is the JNI call, which is expensive. Okay, that's it. So. So this hello world example was actually just an example, a demo, but we can do something more useful. For example, we have there is a Java util random class which has a next int function, and this is implemented in Java, and it doesn't really return real random numbers, but it's a software implementation. Random number generator. But new Intel CPUs, they have a hardware random number generator. And I've detailed here how we can implement a C2 intrinsic now. It means intrinsic for the JIT compiled code for this next int function in the Java util random class. So for this, we first annotate the next int function with the new annotation hotspot intrinsic candidate. Again, in the vm symbols file, we declare our new next int intrinsics, which is exactly the same way it worked for the interpreter. This part is the same for interpreters C1 and C2. Then we have to check if this instruction is available, because it's only available on new CPUs. So again, this is a feature of the hotspot, which works because the hotspot generates the code on the fly. So it's the interpreter is generated on the fly, the JIT compiled code is generated on the fly. So when the hotspot starts, it first looks what hardware is it running on, and then it can act appropriately. So for example, if the hardware has XMM registers, it can use the sinus instruction. If it doesn't has, if you run on a 386, for example, then it will not use the intrinsics, but use the Java implementation. So we have to test for the availability of the LDRand function, and we added a check for that, that startup. And of course, we have to add the new assembler instruction to the hotspot assembler, because until now, it cannot generate such an instruction. It didn't work until now. So here, this assembler actually just emits the bytes for this rand L instruction. And then I told you before how the implementation of the JIT compiler works. So the bytecode is translated into an abstract syntax tree, into a graph. And now we specify a new kind of node. We call it rand E node. And every time when we see a call to random next int, we will the C2 compiler will replace this call by this special node in the tree. And then in the final step, this abstract rand E node will be translated into a machine code which will execute this code. And here is the matching part, the machine part for the abstract node. This is the important part. So it will match against the rand E node, and it will match against the rand E node, and it will generate this machine code for it. So this is, I understand that this looks very complicated. So for example, the hotspot has a tool that's called Ideal Graph Visualizer. And with this tool, you can visualize these graphs I was speaking of for every optimization step. And now when we, I didn't show you the program, I should show you the program before. So we have now the demo for how it works, and we just have a foo function which calls from Java util random secure random. This is our random class. It calls next int, and again we call it in the loop, so it gets JIT optimized. And if you look at the code which is generated for this foo function, this graph will look like this when the next int function has been intrinsified. Actually, there's just a single machine. There's one node left which will be translated into a single machine instruction. And if we don't intrinsify this, the graph will look like this. So you see, you have a dynamic call here somewhere. And if you look at the properties, you will see that this is a call to Java security secure random ng-next bytes. So this is the implementation of the next int function in the hotspot. If you look at the whole graph, oh, sorry, it wasn't this one. you see that's really a huge graph. And you can see here all the bytecodes during parsing. And we have inlining, so you get all these bytecodes, and you can see at every bytecode how this graph grows. And then you have all the optimization steps here before beautify loops, before counted loops, after counted loops, global value number, escape analysis, and so on. So if you want to deep dive into how JIT compilation works in HotSpot, this is a very useful tool. So with our implementation of secure random, we can run that now. We can run it, and it takes like more than 2 seconds without, and with it's enabled by default. And if we disable this intrinsics with disable intrinsics next int, it's slower, but not really slower. So the problem is that the hardware number generator in the CPU is not that fast, but it has the advantage that at least Intel pretends that it really generates random numbers. That's some people don't believe that, and they think there are backdoors inside it. But still, it's good if you combine it with other sources of randomness. It still can be good. Again, if you use the print compilation and print inlining options to look at the program, you will see that now the next int function is intrinsified. And if we disable the next int functions, you see what we've seen before in the graph. Next int inlines secure random next, and secure random next inlines secure random next bytes, and then secure random service provider engine next bytes. This was actually the call which we saw in the graph before. And this cannot be inlined because it's a virtual function and it's too big. And then later on, this function next bytes will be compiled, which again inlines a lot of functions. And this gets a lot of code. If we use again the print opto assembly function to print what the JIT compiler generated, we will see that actually here it generates this rand e node. And if you look, that there's two options: print opto assembly, which gives you a more high level view of the machine nodes which the HotSpot generates, and there is the print assembly options, which prints the real assembler instructions which are emitted at the end. And the output is slightly different, but here you see that again this node actually translates into exactly one machine instructions. And you also have the inlining tree here. You see that random foo actually once invokes next int, but then that's no call, that's just intrinsified. Okay, I think we don't have time for the last example. So all my slides are on GitHub. These are the slides actually, and this is the whole repository with the source code. And if you want, you can try it. If you have questions, you can mail me. So I think that's basically it for now. If you have any questions, I will be happy to answer them now or later, so how you want. So thanks for your attention. So I think we have 5 minutes for...
Yes, any questions? No? Too many GVM keys.
And what could be any possible reason to disable default intrinsics besides the demonstration and testing?
Yeah, actually, you want to run with intrinsics. You're right. So it's usually just for debugging or for development purpose. So sometimes, my last example, I had an example which showed a bug in an intrinsic implementation. So sometimes you run your code and you get a crash, for example. And Then you send this crash to a VM engineer, for example, to me. And then I say, oh, can you please disable this intrinsics and see if it still happens? And then if it doesn't happen without the intrinsics, then I can be pretty sure that the intrinsic has a bug and it's easy to fix. So it's just for development that you can switch them individually on and off. And it must be said that some of the intrinsics, like, for example, AAS or cryptographic intrinsics, but also simple intrinsics like array copy, which I wanted to demonstrate, they are really quite complex because they handle a lot of different cases. So overlapping copy, they copy with vector instructions if they are available, they do loop unrolling and all kind of stuff. So the assembler code for the intrinsics is like hundreds, sometimes thousand lines of code. And you imagine that writing like thousand lines of assembler code is error prone. So that's why you always have this safeguard, like you can disable them and just to check that it still works. You can take the card.
Is there any option to disable all the intrinsics at once?
I don't think so. I don't think, no.
Thank you.
I mean, you can, yeah, no, I don't know. I don't think you.
No. Okay, so say thanks to.
I will be here all day and tomorrow, yeah, yeah. So
you can find. Вы можете найти докладчиков здесь, у них спрашивать еще после перерыва. Также хочу напомнить, что у нас большие перерывы и между докладами у нас есть блиц-доклады. И сейчас нам Жан-Франсуа будет рассказывать про WebSocket и атмосферу. Кому интересно, все туда.
Спасибо.